and almost lost my nephew on this same corner. I thank God for saving his life. I thank God for this man right here, because Jimmy, if it wasn't for believing me and the surveillance that was given to you guys to put out, we wouldn't be where we at right now. We would be trying to figure out what exactly happened, because based on the footage and the 911s, we wouldn't be there. This place used to be a pool hall when I was younger. When I grew up in this community, we had after-school programs. We had schools open up for basketball. We had, you know, game rooms at Jackie Robinson. Right now, what we have is we got schools that are closed after school, and we got churches in our community that are closed too. So when you look at what we need the community and these kids in this community to have some place to go so we could get them off the street, okay? We need better education. We need opportunities. They got a press conference later on today talking about Yale expanding the hospital. But are we getting any jobs? That's what we need. What Yale could do? Newhallville, we're right next to Yale. Let's create some bridge employment. Let's create some training. If you want to donate some money to people that our kids could go there for Wi-Fi, for computers, because everybody in this community ain't got computers. Let's get Wi-Fi in Newhallville. It's like, when you talk about what we need, how about asking the people who grew up here? A lot of these pastors are not from our town. They come, they go, they just here for a certain amount of time, and then they stand in front of y'all like they are leaders. What they are is part-time leaders. And they need to stand with the people in the community that really been here, that know what's going on. This is a big wave, and everybody coming from all over the world want to ride this wave. But when the little waves have come, they're nowhere around. And what our family asks you to do, verify, first of all, what the definition of a community leader is, okay? Go back and look the last 2-3 years when we talked about the gun range, when Mario Boone went over there. I call Mario Boone. Why? Because I live here. We couldn't sleep at night, in the morning. You know what I mean? It was crazy. Where was the clergy and everybody about that? They were saying nothing. Do they really live in this community? I mean, you guys need to verify that. Before you call a press conference, somebody say who they are, you know what I mean? I'm going to tell you who I am. I'm Rodney Williams. That's my nephew. This is my niece. She like my sister. You could verify that. And who I am in the community know who I am. Because I'm old, and I'm not here for the press. I'm here for the community. This, what happened to my nephew, I thank God that he's alive. But like what me and my niece talk about, we want what happened to him to impact our community for the better. And only way it can, how about asking us? We grew up here. A lot of these people you're talking to, the first thing you need to ask them is this. How long you been in New Haven? Are you going to be here in 2 more years? Because like I had to tell one of the pastors yesterday, I was here before you got here, and I'm going to be here when you leave. All my kids, my family live right here. I didn't migrate here, and I'm not leaving. Okay? So that's really what we got to say.
Could we ask Mr. Lee?
Yeah, you can ask.
Do you have a mixed feelings about, you know, like, let's say the church service from Sunday? Would you rather not go on? As a mom, this whole thing has been just a great deal for you to bear.
Mm-hmm.
So what are the feelings? Do you feel that there's, Rodney mentioned leverage, people are leveraging the situation, mm-hmm. but is it really, what agenda do you think they're pushing maybe?
Well, I can't speak for them. I don't know what their agenda is, but I know that based upon what I'm seeing, it's not, their agenda is not my son and my family, because if that was your agenda, you would have reached out, you know. And I feel like as, my grandmother was an evangelist, an apostle in the church. I was raised in the church when my grandmother, you know, took custody of me. My father is his brother, okay? So my grandmother raised me up in the church, you know. My grandmother was a God-fearing woman. So I know what the church is. I know what community outreach is. And that's what my grandmother practiced. You know, she practiced community outreach. Even to her last days, in a wheelchair, you know, a motorized chair, she would go up and down the community to some of her friends' houses who were sick and shut in, who couldn't get out of the bed, you know. So understand this. When you're saying, you know, you're a leader, you're a Christian and this and that, you know, that's outreach. You're supposed to go out into the community and reach out to your community and see what you can do for them. So, yes, I feel like I'm disappointed in the fact that they would make those type of false statements to say that they have been in contact with me when they haven't been. You know, and at the end of the day, like I said, it's not just about my son and Stephanie. It's about this community in its entirety, because next week it could be somebody else's child. You understand? And I don't ever want to see this happen to anyone's kid. I've never been an advocate for community activism or anything like that. You know, I'm a single mom. I raised my two sons by myself, you know. But, again, I always had this fear and this worry, you know, with recent things going on, you know, within the last 10 years. I've always had this worry, but I never thought it would happen to me. And now, like Rodney said, if it was not for this man here, the questions would have been all over the place. You know, they would have been making all kind of false statements and false accusations. And I thank him because, you know, in a sense, you know, he made our case, you know. And it's like there needs to be more of that in our community. And it starts with the leaders. It starts with the community leaders. If you're a pastors and stuff, you guys need to get together. You guys have churches all over the place. If you look around, there's a couple of churches within the last two blocks. There's at least five churches. There should be no reason why there's not an outpour of outreach and help for these kids. Open up some of your churches and allow these kids. You know, you want to get on camera? Get on camera and say, listen, we're going to do Sunday service after for the youth for 2 hours. You know, do something else for the community. Don't just make it about your agenda. I feel like that these ministers are really just, I don't even know why they're here. Because, I mean, my thing is, if you're here for me, then somebody should have called me.
Hey, Keisha, one of the most important questions is, how is Paul doing?
The best that he can.
And we thank you for asking.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people, our community has been excellent. Our neighbors, people up the street, people from around the corner, from two towns over, excellent. We thank you for all your support. But like she said, all these leaders.
It's the community. It's the community that's rallying around behind him. The guy that at the store across the street, he came to the house that day. He was crying. He thought my son was there. He's like, please tell me, you know, that Paulie, no. Again, because they're in the community. They see these kids every day. So that's somebody that's important to him. That's somebody that always comes to the store and does things. So I think that, you know, and I think, like, you know, some of the Black Lives Matters ladies that I have not gotten in contact with, these ladies have been rallying for him since this all happened. I thank them. They never called me and asked me, could they do an interview? Could I come to any rally? To nothing. These ladies just been out there pounding the pavement for these kids, for just justice. And I thank them. That's the type of thing that I'm talking about. When you say community, that's community love. Yeah. But Paul is, you know, he's doing the best that he can, you know.
You talked off camera before, mm-hmm, about some of the things he's experiencing. Would you mind sharing that?
I think that's something more personal that I you know, that's not for them, you know.
But I'm gonna let you get back to her. But she talked about the service yesterday. I want to be clear about one thing. The people that was invited to the service was the Hamden mayor, the New Haven mayor, the Hamden chief, the New Haven chief, the Yale PD, and then Taisha Walker, the president of the Board of Alders. So when you look at the lineup and you look at the fact that I live in this community, I was the co-chair of Ward 21, I was the vice chair of the Dixwell management team right by their church, and they not reach out to my family to at least speak to the congregation. To me, it looked more political, because unless Taisha Walker is a minister, why would she be invited and not us? So when you talk about community healing, our family needs to heal.
But then you having all those people there, that it's crazy, because I didn't even know all those people were there.
No,
but
they didn't go. They didn't go. And I thank them for not showing up.
Okay. Because, I mean, how do you have that type of meeting and not have the victims there or the victims' parents there? Because aren't you talking about the situation that happened? Wouldn't you want to be able to speak to us and our voice be heard? Wouldn't the chiefs and stuff want to be able to hear what we have to say? I mean, the mayor of Hamden has been excellent. Me and him sat down and had like a two-hour conversation. He's been excellent, and I thank him for reaching out to my uncle and setting up the meeting. He's been more than helpful, and we're supposed to meet up with him again, you know, to further the conversation. But the mayor of Hamden has been very, very good, and I thank him for that. I have not heard from the chief yet, but the mayor, you know, it's been very a good rapport with him.
Keisha, Rodney mentioned you had a meeting with President Peter Salve. Were you at that meeting as well?
I had a meeting right before that rally, because we was upset about the fact that the clergy went into a meeting with the Yale president before my family got opportunity. So he did immediately get me in there with a conversation, and he did tell me that he will be setting up a meeting, so I will be getting my niece into a meeting with him. And based on that meeting, I feel like, you know, I appreciate everything he is talking about. And the truth is this, it's about identifying who are the leaders. The leaders of the community need to be the one in the room. And that's what I told the president, yeah, you need to verify who the leaders are before you meet with people.
You've spoken to this to some extent, but what do you want to see happen after all this? What do you want to see happen next?
Besides justice?
I mean, do you mean as far as the case or as far as the community? Can I speak with the case?
Sure.
Honestly, as far as the case, I really would like to see these guys fired. I mean, I think it was just a careless act of, it was just inappropriate. I mean, you know, you see online a lot of people are saying that, you know, he got out the car and he put his hands up. He was instructed to do so. What else? What more do you want? We put our hands up and you still shoot us? What more do you want us to do? So, I mean, to me, I feel like they should absolutely be fired. I mean, will they go to jail? I don't know, but I would like to see them, because if it was one of us and a shootout happened, we'd absolutely be locked under the jail, you know? We would not be fired with pay. Absolutely, we'd be gone a long time ago. So I would like to see them imprisoned, and I also would like to see them stripped of any type of way to get another civil service job anywhere else. I don't think they should be able to be police officers anywhere else, because wherever they go, to me, they're a liability. So I don't think they should be able to police anywhere else. So, I mean, that's what I would like to see. And as far as the community, I would love to see more done, more happen, you know, as far as maybe, like my uncle was saying, youth activities, because, you know, it starts when they're young. You need to keep these kids busy. You know, when I was growing up, Jackie Robinson used to have a game room. So after we got out of school, we would go to the game room, and, you know, there was things there. The Q House was open. You know, there was a lot of little community, little things that was going on here. There was a lot of things to do. Now you take everything from these kids and expect these kids to still be productive. And that's not fair to them. You know what I mean? So I'm just hoping that it...
And also, you know, the police need to come out more. Know who you're dealing with.
That's one of the things.
Everything can't be, I'm scared. You're the police. Yeah. We shouldn't be scared of you.
That's one of the things that I mentioned to
the
mayor.
We try to train our kids to not
be afraid.
Listen to them. If they tell you to do something, put your hands up.
Comply.
And that's what he did.
Yeah.
You know, at the end of the day, they shouldn't fear for their lives, not when it comes to the men in blue. That shouldn't be an issue.
It's just like if you live in Danbury or Manchester. Danbury and Manchester is not the same as New Haven. It's a totally different atmosphere. We all agree? So when you fill out that application to be a New Haven or a Hamden or wherever closer to the city, when you fill out that application, you're not policing Manchester. You're not policing Guilford. You're coming into an inner city where the population is mostly black. And like I told the mayor, imagine if the cop that policed your community, because, you know, they have a beat for a year or whatever their beat is. Imagine if that cop had to go home to that community that he walked around in every day. Imagine that. Imagine if he's seen you get up every day, every morning, and y'all go to work, or y'all meet up at Dunkin' Donuts, or y'all kids are outside playing, or, you know, you're having a cookout, he's having a cookout. Imagine the connection that officer could have with that community, because now he know who he policing. He knows where you work. He knows that you have a job. He knows that that's your son. The guys that he may pull over, that he may fear because he goes home to Manchester, he fears them. You come to this town, and I understand that because, you know, it's an inner city. So, you know, maybe these people have this fear of the community, but if you fear the community, don't work here.
That's right.
If you don't want to get to know the residents, don't come here. Go get the job where you live at. If you don't care enough about our black and brown children to get to know them, don't come here. Go police in your town where it may be easier for you, where you're not afraid. You can't come here and be afraid of us when you don't know us. So my requirement is that live here 6 months to a year. Then you'll know who we are. I remember coming up, and I knew the police. They would stop and play basketball with us, all kind of stuff, jump rope. It's not like that now. So I think that you should have to live in the community that you're policing, because at the end of the day, it's our money that pays you. Why should we be afraid of you? We're paying you to be afraid of you? That doesn't make sense to me. So that's what I would like to see, I mean, ultimately happen, you know?
So a warrant was actually recently released for the Hamden officer. What's your reaction to that? Do you believe that this might be a road to justice for you?
I'm hoping so. I mean, to me, I feel like if it don't, it would be an injustice, not only to me and my son and Stephanie and her family, but it would be an injustice to the community. I think that if they don't really pursue this and do the right thing, it's going to be an injustice, not only to New Haven, but Hamden as well.
One thing I want to add, when you look at what happened at the synagogue, this young man went up in there and shot these people up and killed them. They were shooting at him, running down the street. When he got out the car and put his hands up, they didn't shoot him and kill him. There's incident after incident after incident that we could talk about.
Mm-hmm.
White people shooting a whole bunch of people. When they finally get them, they want to arrest them and interrogate them. What is the difference between arresting somebody white to interrogate them and arresting somebody black to interrogate them? To me, the police don't respect black and brown people as human beings, because the first thing they want to do to us is shoot us. Now, if anybody should have got shot, that guy who just shot them people up, they should have shot him. My nephew didn't shoot nobody. He got out with his hands up, and they tried to kill him.
No weapons found, not even a screwdriver. You know?
Why is it that they're not shooting white people?
I mean, when the last time?
When they should.
When the last time you heard cases? About a black officer shooting down a white person? It's virtually unheard of. You know, when the last time you've heard of an incident like that? Choked them out, done anything to them? You don't hear about it. And, you know, it's sad to say that it's like we're almost repeating. Like we're going backwards instead of going forward. You know, our ancestors fought a lot for us to be free. And we're not even free to this day. I'm afraid for my life. At 42 years old, you know, you never know what you're going to expect. And again, a false call, false complaint. These guys, again, I believe they were afraid. You know, once I heard the 911 call, I believe they were afraid. But we pay you not to be afraid. You're a police officer. You are trained.
Their actions show that they was afraid.
Yeah.
Because no trained cop is going to get out shooting like that. There's no way.
Guys, and they're not going to, you know, so their beat is over the line. But I think we were all surprised that the Hamden officers aren't part of the New Haven District Police meetings, the criminal intelligence meetings, the CompStat meetings, when in fact, They're the next door neighbors, and Highwood reflects Dixwell's home to a great degree.
True.
Why aren't those Hamden officers involved?
Right.
That would be something that you would have to talk to the community leaders about. I have no idea. Like, I literally live on Morris Street, which is the street over from over there by Highwood. So, but I grew up right there on 769 Dixwell Avenue, literally on the line. My grandmother was a single mother of a lot of children, and she owned her own home. You know, so we know because my grandmother used to be, like, involved in the community when Dr. Mayo and stuff was around. She worked for the school system. So, you know, I know a little bit about politics and stuff like that. But as far as, like, why are they not included, they should be. Because that line is where you see a lot of more of the discrimination that I'm talking about.
And that can make all the difference.
Yeah.
Just that line can make all the difference.
When you talk about Goodrich Street, Morris Street, that's more where where the black community is, you know? And that's a lot where they sit around, they watch you, they sit on that corner sometimes 2 and 3 hours, you know? And again, I don't know why they do it. I don't know if that's protocol. I'm not sure. But if there is a meeting, maybe New Haven and Hamden should collab, especially those that are policing that borderline, maybe they should have that talk. And I will, you know, talk to the mayor about seeing what we can do about that too. That's a good idea. Anyone else?
Can I just have you sit your fiance? Mm-hmm.
Jasmine Evans. First name? Jasmine.
Yep.
Well,
we appreciate all you guys having us, and I mean, hopefully next time we'll be able to meet on different circumstances. Maybe it'll be all good news, you know?
Indictment, or the guy getting fired.
Or something better going on in this community, something that we can do for this community. Maybe we can reopen something for these kids to do. So maybe we'll all get together on something like that on the next meeting. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.